morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to our worship service today on this August 13th, the 11th Sunday after Pentecost. Our worship theme for today focuses upon God's gracious blessings to protect and keep us safe from all harm and danger as He watches over us and blesses us with our faith in Him, our Lord and Savior. To begin our service this morning, joining together in our opening hymn number 847.
Thank you.
And also with you.
We have come into the presence of God, who created us to love and serve him as his dear children. But we have disobeyed him and deserve only his wrath and punishment. Therefore, let us confess our sins to him and plead for his mercy. Merciful Father in heaven, I am altogether sinful from birth. In countless ways I have sinned against you, and do not deserve to be called your child. But trusting in Jesus, my Savior, I pray, have mercy on me, according to your unfailing love. Cleanse me from my sin, and take away my guilt.
God, our Heavenly Father, has forgiven all your sins. By the perfect life and innocent death of our Lord Jesus Christ, he has removed your guilt forever. You are his own dear child. May God give you strength to live according to his will.
Amen.
In the peace of forgiveness, let us praise the Lord.
Hazael as king over Aram. You will also anoint Jehu, son son of Nimshi, as king over Israel, and Elisha, son of Shaphat, from Abel-Meholah, as prophet in your place. Whoever escapes the sword of Hazael, Jehu will kill, and whoever escapes the sword of Jehu, Elisha will kill. But I have preserved in Israel 7,000 whose knees have not been to Baal and whose lips have not kissed him. Here ends our first lesson. We join now in the singing of Psalm 73 in the front portion of our hymnal.
Things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us.
For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither things present nor things to come, nor powerful forces, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in creation, will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Here ends our second lesson. We join the verse of the day.
Could you come up here with me? Come on, can you not come up here? Come up here with me. Can you come up here with me? Come on. Come on. Stand up. Okay. How are you this morning? All right? Now, I want you to hold my hand so that I don't trip and fall down. Okay? All right? Now, are you holding my hand? Yeah? Well, I hate to disagree with you, but I'm actually holding your hand. And isn't that the way it often is? How often do we, grandparents, say to one of our little grandchildren, you know, hold grandma or grandpa's hand so that we don't get lost at the fair, or something to that effect. There's an old story about a man and his little boy who were walking one winter day. And the father had a hold of his son's hand. And as they were walking, the little boy stepped on some ice and slipped. Have you ever slipped on ice? Yeah. And so his father squeezed his hand tighter and held on to him and pulled him up so that he didn't fall down and hurt himself. And then can you guess what the little boy said? He said, "Dad, it's a good thing I was holding your hand. Otherwise, you might have fallen." And that's really the point of our sermon this morning. That it's not so important that as a child of God that I'm holding on to Jesus' hand. It's important to remember that Jesus is holding on to my hand. And if I start to slip or I start to fall, just like your daddy is holding your hand, would hold you up so nothing bad happens to you. So Jesus is holding our hand and will hold us so that nothing bad happens to us. Okay, would you pray? Dear Lord Jesus, thank you for holding on to us so that we don't fall. We trust that you will take care of us. You always see us, and we are always within your reach so that you can protect us. We thank you, Jesus. Amen. All right, we'll continue with the next tip. The Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. The basis for our sermon is the gospel lesson for this Sunday. In the name of our Savior Jesus Christ, dearly loved by God, some people, and you may be one of them, is deathly afraid of being on the water. And you ask them, and they'll say, "It's not so much that I'm afraid of the water, I'm really afraid of drowning." The idea of water filling our lungs and sinking us down to the depths is a frightening one for everyone. The memory of my two good friends, Tom and Bill, who drowned in Michigan lakes the summer before our sophomore year in high school, remains with me to this day. Drowning also is used as a metaphor for having the problems and troubles of life rule over us. In a movie, Jack Nicholson's character says to another character who was giving him advice that he didn't find particularly helpful in his predicament, said, "I'm drowning here and you're describing the water." Have you ever felt like the troubles and difficulties and challenges of life are sinking you down? What about the guilt in our consciences, whether it's real or imagined, that fills our hearts and our minds, that pushes us down into sadness and maybe even depression? It is impossible to prevent those kinds of things from coming into our lives. But there is a way that you and I can keep them from killing us, from drowning us, from sinking us down to the depths. That way is keeping our eyes fixed on Jesus, our Savior. Particularly when we think of the guilt that we confess this morning, how it can get to us, we realize how much it can cause us to sink. We even sing in one of our well-known hymns, "What Wondrous Love Is This?" You know the verse. "When I was sinking down beneath God's righteous frown." This morning we're going to look at that way, as Peter did, to keep from drowning. And we'll see that Jesus takes hold of us so that we don't sink. We'll see, first of all, that we are never out of Jesus' sight. And also, that we are never out of Jesus' reach. Let me begin this morning by just reminding us that this is not a word of God that teaches us about Peter. It's a word of God that teaches us about Jesus. This miracle, for full disclosure, as they say, is one of my favorites, if not my favorite, because it just so unmistakably shows us Jesus' power as God. Jesus came towards them, walking on the water. It unmistakably shows Jesus' love as he reached down and kept Peter from sinking, even as Peter's heart was filled with doubt and fear when he looked around him. Jesus walked on the water because he, in his omniscience, saw that out in the middle of the Sea of Galilee, a sudden violent storm had arisen, and the boat was being pounded by the waves because the wind was against it. And so Jesus came down from the mountain where he was praying, and he began to walk out on the water, probably out to about the middle of the lake, somewhere between 3 and 5 o'clock in the morning. It was dark, it was a stormy night. When the disciples saw this figure coming toward them, they didn't recognize that it was Jesus. In fact, they cried out because they thought it was a ghost, and they were very afraid. The disciples, like many people in those days, and as are we by nature, very superstitious. And so they thought that they were seeing an apparition, a spirit, a ghost. Their Lord was quick to dispel that false belief, one that the second commandment clearly forbids practicing superstition, and identified himself to that, to who he was. "Take heart, it is I. Do not be afraid." That little phrase, "it is I," is essentially the same phrase that the Son of God used from the burning bush when he told Moses, who was sending him to Pharaoh, "I am who I am." So when Jesus says, "It is I," he was telling the disciples, "I am who I am. It's your Savior, it's your Lord. It is God who is here, because I've seen you in your need." Now, Peter knew who it was that was walking toward him. And he said, "Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you on the water." We can understand that word "if" in the sense of "since." So Peter was saying, "Lord, since it's you, I see who you are now, and I trust you. Since it's you, tell me to come out of the boat and to walk on the water and come to you." What an impetuous request. A request for something impossible. But what did the Lord say? What was the word of God to Peter? "Come." And so when Peter stepped out from the boat and walked on the water toward Jesus, he had his eyes fixed on Jesus. And here's our lesson. The child of God, in response to God's word, with our eyes fixed on Jesus, step out and can do even what is humanly impossible. Peter's eyes were fixed on Jesus. Where were Jesus' eyes fixed? Where was Jesus looking? Well, he was looking right at Peter as he walked on the water toward him. The eyes of the one whose eye is even on the sparrow was on his child so that nothing bad would happen to him. He could see what was going on. We can't say the same for Peter, that his eyes remained fixed on Jesus as Jesus' eyes remained fixed on him. Peter took his eye off the ball. Peter took his eyes off Jesus and began to look around instead at his attendant circumstances. Who does that remind us of? It reminds us of us, doesn't it? Sometimes when we take our eyes off Jesus and look instead at our attendant circumstances, and we begin to sin. Peter looked around and noticed that it was storming, that there was a very high wind blowing against him. I'm sure he couldn't help but notice the high, choppy waves that were coming up against him. And maybe he even realized, "I'm walking on water here." And he began to sink. Keep your eyes fixed on Jesus. Don't take them off him and look at our attendant circumstances, because those circumstances likely will make us afraid. But when we keep looking at Jesus, when our eyes don't leave him, then we're able to do even what is humanly impossible, as God wills it for us in our lives. Don't look at the winds and the waves, either literally or figuratively, but look at him who is the great I Am, who reached out those same hands that he would reach out to Peter and stretch them out on the cross to be crucified, to bleed, to suffer and die, to pay for our sins of fear and doubt and lack of courage, of worry. Jesus didn't let Peter get away with his lack of faith in him. Now, we don't in any way say that Peter lost his faith. He took his eyes off Jesus, the object, the strength of his faith, and as a result, he began to sink. But when he began to sink, what did he do? The very first thing he did was call out, "Lord, save me." Even though his faith was not perfect, and under the circumstances was failing, he still had faith in his Lord and cried out to the object that would save him. Who would save him? He trusted in that word of God that promises us, whoever calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. And Peter called on the name of the Lord, and he was saved. Jesus said to him, "You of little faith, why'd you doubt?" And then he reached out his hand and he grabbed a hold of Peter so that Peter would not sink. Jesus reaches out his hand so that we don't sink. We are never out of Jesus' sight, and we are never out of Jesus' reach. Our courage lies not so much in the knowledge that I'm holding on to Jesus. Courage comes with the knowledge that Jesus is holding on to me. And this is the vital point of the miracle, that he, the Son of Man, who is also God, who came into this world to live for us and die for us, always sees us, always holds on to us. So even as we begin to sink, he will keep us and preserve and protect us so that we do not drown and die. Our faith will not drown and die. This is the promise of the Holy Spirit, to preserve and keep us through our lives until we obtain heaven. Peter did not reach up for Jesus. Jesus reached down to grab his weak child's hand. Faith does not save us because it holds on to Christ. Faith saves us because faith gives us Christ, to whom we hold on, or rather, who holds on to us. Faith is not saving because we hold Christ. Faith saves because it gives us Christ, who holds on to us. God never promises that we will avoid those troubles and storms in life. There will be times when particularly our guilt will try to drive us down to the depths of the sea. But remember what God says about our sins. He has cast all our sins in the depths of the sea. I don't need to go down to the depths under the weight of trouble and guilt, because God has taken all my sins and their guilt and put them at the depths of the sea. And so I don't need to go there. There was one time particularly when the message of the power and love of this miracle really comes into focus, and that is at the hour of our death, of our deaths. If we have time to prepare for them. And I guess we all do have that, maybe not right at the moment, but today is the day we're preparing for death, isn't it? As we hear the word of God. As Jesus reaches down to us in the gospel of forgiveness and love in his sacrifice for us. As we prepare for death, whenever that may be, the question isn't, am I holding on to Jesus? The confidence is, Jesus is holding on to me. When I begin to doubt, when I begin to fear and begin to sink, I call out, Lord, save me. And we hear the voice of our Savior say, take heart, it is I. Do not be afraid. Even as my faith is shuddering under fear, Jesus is right there, and he reaches out and saves me and takes hold of me. There was another time when Jesus' disciples were out in the boat and they got caught in a storm. They woke Jesus up, and Jesus calmed the storm. Well, he did that again this time. When he and Peter got back in the boat, the winds stopped. And then Matthew tells us that what the disciples had seen and what Jesus had said, the word of God, had strengthened their faith. The Holy Spirit had strengthened their faith, and they said, truly, you are the Son of God. Matthew's account was meant to strengthen the disciples. The miracle of Matthew's account was meant to strengthen the disciples' faith. It is meant to strengthen our faith as well. It may be storming out there. We may have impetuously asked God to enable us to do what seemingly is humanly impossible for us or for someone else. And maybe doubts and fears begin to fill our hearts and weigh us down, and we begin to sink. But here's what will happen every time, just as it's happened in the past. Jesus takes hold of us so we don't sink. And then we worship him, and then we confess his name. Truly, you are the Son of God. Amen. And now the peace of God that surpasses all understanding shall guard your hearts and your minds through Christ Jesus. Amen. Please stand and join me in confessing our Christian faith with the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints,
the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Please be seated.
Lord, for your blessings, thanks we bring. With hearts and graces now we sing our praise to you for all your love that comes to us from heaven above. Lord, may the love you have for me shine forth in me for all to see. And may your love my guide now be until your face in heaven I see. Amen.
In our prayers for today, we also offer up a prayer of thanks for the years of blessing the Lord has given to Wayne and Elva Zulliger, who are celebrating their wedding anniversary, and also to Elroy and Michelle Moss, who are celebrating their anniversaries. We also offer up a prayer of comfort for the family of Margaret Ross, whom the Lord has called to her eternal home in heaven. Please stand as we join in prayer. We begin with our responsive prayer that begins on page 6 in our morning bulletin. Let us pray. Lord God, our maker and preserver, we praise and thank you for all that you give us day after day.
You are not worthy of all the mercies you show us.
You have given us your precious word to nourish our souls and to protect us from the temptations of the devil, the world, and our sinful nature. Shield us from every kind of danger, sudden catastrophe, terrors of crime, and the pain of disease. Watch over those who travel by land, sea, and air. Keep our loved ones from whatever perils may threaten them. Our government and schools upright and strong for the advancement of good citizenship and useful vocations, that we may enjoy the gifts of peace, security, and well-being.
Grant your blessings to every nation on earth, where there are wars, fear, peace, where there is safety, let it be healed, where there is poverty, danger, or disaster. Come with your almighty power to
You instituted the bond of marriage when you created Adam and Eve and brought them together in the bond of marriage in the Garden of Eden. You have blessed Wayne and Elda Zuliger with 65 years together as Christian husband and wife, and have blessed Elroy and Michelle Moss with 40 years together as Christian husband and wife. As you have blessed them with these many years together, continue to bless and keep them in your love for each other and their love for you. May your love fill our Christian homes and families with your blessings. Guide our young men and women to seek a good and faithful spouse. Continue to bless our Christian homes with your word and our faith, that you may guide us in all things that are good and pleasing to you. In your wisdom and grace, Lord, you have called all of this world to yourself in heaven, the soul of Margaret Boss. Comfort all who mourn her death with the peace to know that you have taken her to be with you forever in your heavenly home. When the day comes, help us all to be prepared in true faith in you for us to leave this earthly life. In recent days, we have learned of many who have suffered great losses through raging fires, storms, and extreme heat. We know, Lord, that you are in control of all things in heaven and on earth. Comfort those who have suffered loss, move those who are able to offer help and assistance, and spare your people, we pray, from all such calamities. We give you our thanks for the much-needed rain you have sent. Continue, we ask, O Lord, to send the rain and sunshine that is needed to water the earth and cause our crops to grow and prosper. May we never forget your promises that seed time and harvest will not fail, and that you will indeed provide for all our needs. In coming days, as our students return to school at our Trinity St. Luke's Lutheran School, Lakeside Lutheran and Luther Prep, be with them and guide them in their studies and learning to grow in your grace and wisdom. Bless and guide our called teachers as they guide the students in your word. Be with our students, also who are attending our public schools, colleges, and universities, keep them faithful to you. Protect and keep all our students safe from all harm and danger of body and soul, we pray. And hear us, Lord, as we bring you our private petitions. We bring these requests before you in the name of Jesus our Lord and ask you to hear us. Take all that we have, our bodies and minds, our time and skills, our ministries and offerings, and use them to your glory.
We give ourselves to you, that we may serve you in whatever way is pleasing in your sight. Amen.
And in our Lord's name we pray, our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
O Lord God, our Heavenly Father, pour out the Holy Spirit on your faithful people. Keep us strong in your grace and truth, protect and comfort us in all temptation, and bestow on us your saving peace through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Brothers and sisters, go in peace, live in harmony with one another, serve the Lord with gladness. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with favor and give you peace.
Thank you.
Good morning once again, and thank you for joining us for our worship service this morning. We send a very special thank you to our students from local preparatory school who are back for their studies, some of them already for the athletic events. Thank you for joining us and come to worship with us again very soon. Our thanks to Pastor Furch for the message of God's word today to guide us and encourage us to know that our Lord is always with us. And our thanks to Mr. Stumble for leading us in our songs today and for ushers for serving also. Please join us for a fellowship time following the service this morning. A couple of reminders of events that are scheduled here in our bulletin. A very important one: next Sunday following our late service, we will be extending another call for a pastor to come and serve us here at Trinity Lutheran. Please let us not only here in church, but in our homes and our lives, remember to ask the Lord to guide our congregation and to guide that one whom we call, that he might come to serve us here in the work of God's kingdom. Also, another reminder or special notice here that our altar flowers for today have been provided by Elroy and Michelle Moss, as noted in our bulletin, who are celebrating their 40th wedding anniversary, and also flowers on the altar here for the 65th wedding anniversary of Wayne and Elda Zulliger that have been given in honor and thanks to the Lord by their family. May the Lord continue to bless them and keep all of us in his loving care. May he bring you back to his house of worship again very soon. God be with you all.